Right, hello everyone. Thanks for joining the ACFR and CIRIS seminar today. I'm excited that today we have Professor Sylvain Gigon from Paris. It's quite early for him, so I'm glad he's speaking to us at this hour. So Professor Gigon is Professor of Physics at the Sorbonne University in Paris, and also a group leader at the Laboratoire Kassler-Broussel, sorry, I can't pronounce that, at ENS Paris. His research interests range from fundamental investigations of light propagation in complex media, biomedical imaging, computational imaging, signal processing, to quantum optics and quantum information in complex media. He's also the co-founder of a spin-off LightOn and aiming to perform optical computing for machine learning and big data. And today he'll talk to us about optics for artificial intelligence and actually give us a tutorial about that. So without further ado, the floor is yours.
So thank you very much, Costas. So I'm very glad to be here, and it's not that early. It's 8 o'clock in the morning here in Paris. So I will try to give you this overview of optics for artificial intelligence. Again, I understand that most of the audience is not optics, but it should remain at a relatively simple level. So hopefully, I hope everyone can follow. But please don't hesitate to interrupt me or stop me if you have any questions. So as Costa said, I'm in Paris. I'm based in Paris, and we are from a physics background, but we are doing a lot of things that are related to engineering. So, okay, so let me start. So I want to, of course, you all know and are using machine learning, and I was giving here some examples of using machine learning for optics. So you can, for instance, apply machine learning to data analysis, to information storage, to quantum information, to basically designing structures for optics. So, and I'm sure you have many such examples in robotics. But what I want to talk about today is the opposite. So how can we use optics for machine learning rather than the vice versa? And why optics can be an interesting way to do some machine learning at interesting scale and speed. So this is what I want to talk about today. I want to give a brief introduction to machine learning. I mean, it's probably from the point of view of how to make the computation. And I want to review a little bit the current hardware for AI that we're all using and why optics will be useful. And I want to give you a little bit of the state of the art with one example actually from my lab, which is one of many ways to do some machine learning with optics. Okay, so AI, what's AI? So it's actually a big thing, and you can actually see it as a structured, nested concept. And deep learning is just one of these concepts. It's one kind of neural networks, but of course, it's artificial intelligence is much broader. So in the 80s and 90s, for those who have seen this period, artificial intelligence was more like decision tree. You have some kind of choice, and you have a result that depends on multiple choice. And of course, that's really far from what it is to nowadays. And nowadays, it's more about automatic data analysis. So I'm here putting also three of possible things you can do with machine learning. I will focus today on more supervised learning and classification. But of course, many of the concepts I'm discussing today would apply also to the other type of data analysis. So I will focus maybe on one example that is a very, for the sake of simplicity, that is a very simple one, which is the automatic written digit recognition that allows me to explain most of the concept. And this is the so-called MNIST dataset, which many of you that have been playing with machine learning have been playing with. So it's basically written numbers in black and whites. Each of them is basically 28 by 28 pixels. You have 10 class, which are basically the number that the picture is representing from 0 to 9. So the 28 pixels square mean that the dimension, each image is 784 pixels. And when you want to play with this data set, you have about 60,000 images, which is a learning set with which you can basically train your machine learning, and about 10,000 for testing. So that's maybe familiar to some of you. So this is one example, for instance, just the eights and just a part of the edge. So you can see the diversity in written numbers. And but it's a bit interesting. I want to show you a little bit what the data looks like. So in a way, you can think of this data set as basically vectors. So each image is actually a vector. So you have 60,000 such vectors. And the dimension of each vector is 784. It's basically the number of pixels. So it's very hard to represent what it looks like. But what you can do is kind of take a low dimensional representation of that. So if you would look at these 60,000 vectors in two-dimensional space by kind of projecting it in some way, this is what you would get. You would get basically each vector would be now one point in this 2D space. And if you now represent the class, you would see that there is some the image will regroup by each color would correspond to type of number, and they would group in a way that in such a way that if you would be a way to kind of draw lines between these groups, you could separate in a relatively easy way the groups from each other. So of course with some orange dot, for instance, in the middle of the blue dots, but overwhelmingly they would basically regroup in a way that you can visually separate them. So that's one way to do it. And in order to process that automatically, there's many ways. You can do some kind of classify one unknown numbers by, you know, looking who are its neighbors and so on. But what you do normally is you use your brain, and your brain is actually an excellent neural network. And I will develop the analogy later on. So the human brain is actually extremely good at distinguishing these numbers without doing any numerical algebra. And the brain to put the numbers, it's about 10 to the 11 neurons. Each neuron is about connected to about 10,000 others. So you have about 10 to the 15 synapses. So that's a huge number, of course, and it's extremely slow. So the brain reacts and communicates internally at about millisecond timescale. But still, if you put the numbers of operation that the brain can do, it's about 30 petaops per second. So number peta, it's 10 to the 15, and ops is a number of operation, equivalent operation per second. So we'll show later what we can do with conventional hardware. But all this is done with about 20 watts of power consumption, which is extremely low when you will see the numbers we see later. And of course the brain is extremely complex, and it can also remodel and learn by itself. So at the basis, what you have is really neurons that are basically this is really some the earliest design of neurons. But nowadays in optics, we are able to basically see those neurons and even see them in action, and to observe the circuitry of the brain. So that's not the topic of my talk today. I will really focus on how can we mimic the brain in hardware. So if you take one neuron, it's basically made of a central blob that is where the nucleus is. So this is the neuron itself, and the neuron the center of the neuron is connected to other neurons by some connection, axons, which basically can connect at terminally with other neurons. And if you want to make some mathematical representation that represent the action of a neuron, you can basically represent it as basically an integrator. So the neurons has some input, which are other neurons, and there are some weights that is basically summing, and the overall response will be basically carried away to other neurons to activate them. So you can represent mathematically in an extremely simplified fashion the action of a neuron as integrating and summing with some weights the effect of other neurons. So in a way, if you represent it mathematically, you see that what you need to do mathematically is multiply numbers and accumulate them. So it's called the multiply and accumulate operation. You need to tune the weights. And there is also something important, that is you need a nonlinear activation function. So you need something that doesn't react linearly to the amount of inputs, but in a nonlinear way. And you can show that if you do this, you can basically build series of neurons like that, what is called a linear classifier, which is able to linearly separate, classify some inputs that would come. So what people have been trying first is to basically make that in hardware. And this is the so-called perceptron that was built in the 60s by Frank Rosenblatt. And it's exactly basically this with basically wires and a potentiometer and so on and so forth. So it was, of course, a huge device, and it could perform some very simple operation. And you can see that it's much more complex than the brain, even though it's much more, let's say, simple in terms of number of neurons and connection, but it's much bigger and, of course, consuming a huge amount of power. So what people have been doing then is basically trying to make this a little bit more complicated. And so they've shown that if you stack layers after layers of neurons, so it's called a multi-layer perceptron. So you have one input layer, which is connected to some neurons, and then more of them. And what you do is you have some adjustable all-to-all connectivity in each layer. And you want to basically find the right weights in order to approximate, for instance, and classify in a better way your input data. So if you do this, you can show that you can, with this multi-layer perceptron, you can basically realize a nonlinear classifier. So you are now able to basically define better the boundaries between these regions. And you can get on this NIST data set of the up to about 99% accuracy with this kind of multi-layer networks. So what's happening? So in each, whenever you go from one layer to the next, you need to basically compute about n times m, where n is the number of input and output neurons, a matrix multiplication to calculate the weight, and then of course some summation and so on. But the main effort here is the matrix multiplication that you have to do in the computer. Okay, so this is just to show you what a multi-layer perceptron would look like for classification. So it's like now there is three hidden layers. There's about 10,000 hidden neurons in the internal layers, and it corresponds to about here 25 million synapses, so connections between those neurons. So I'm only showing here about 2% in this. Only 2% of the neurons are shown. And you can see that whenever you display something after a multiple layer, you have these 10 classes at the end, and you can really identify with a good efficiency the neuron that is the most excited, give you the class of the input images in an automatic way. So the number of connections here is huge. So it's actually a lot of computation to a lot of multiplication and accumulate to actually get the result here. Okay, so it has been refined beyond this fully connected layer to convolutional layers, where it's equivalent to a layer but with a very specific structure, so which is equivalent to a convolution. So you can basically perform some kind of small filter that will analyze a small area of the input data set, for instance detecting edges or doing some averaging. And I'm making a teaser here that optics is actually very good at making this operation in another analog way. And so you can, if you know a little bit about optics, you realize that this is an operation that we would do extremely easily in optics. So when you do this, you can actually show that you can have extremely efficient architecture that would basically be a series of input of convolutional layer. Usually you have some dense layer at the end, and you can again identify with a good accuracy and with a relatively explainable architecture what is happening. So for instance, you may have been using, if you do image analysis, this so-called VGG16 network architecture, which has a very typical architecture that have shown to be very good for image analysis. Okay, so an important part is how to train a network. So when you go forward, you put an image and you get a result. It's called inference. But of course, the part where you want to train the network and find the weight is done most overwhelmingly with so-called backpropagation or backprop, which is the de facto standard for training. So it's extremely intensive. You have to go one layer after from the last one to the first one, compute gradients, and this tells you how to change the weight in order to reach a better accuracy. So you kind of find a minimum of a function, and you have to do it layer by layer. So it's actually extremely power intensive, but it also constrained to this layered neural network architecture. So this architecture has been adopted also because there is a good algorithm to train it, which is relatively efficient, which is backprop. Okay, so I just want to point out, and that many of you playing with this kind of data set are probably aware of it, that NIST, although it looks very complicated with these 25 million neurons to classify, is actually extremely small. So this is 50K example, 10 class. It takes about 50 megabytes. But nowadays, image data sets are much bigger. So millions of images, thousands of classes, in this case, 150 gigabytes. There's even some bigger one that may or may not be public with 300 million images. And of course, there's not just images. So you can also analyze sound. So this is, for instance, music tracks. You have also, of course, speech and text. I mean, text is still relatively small, but speech is actually quite big data sets. And also for driving, you have, for instance, extremely large, also multimodal data set, like with LIDAR, images, et cetera, et cetera. The take-home message is this is just a handful of the thousands of public data sets of all kind of size. And of course, this is just public data set, but probably there are some private data set that are much bigger and but may not be accessible to all researchers. Okay, so the state of the art nowadays is deep learning. So it's really the fact of using this deep layer network with a very complex architecture that basically process the information from a very raw form initially to more and more higher level interpretation. So this is, of course, the state of the art in basically everything nowadays. And I just want to point out that it's really now up to hundreds of layers. Each layer, as we said, is a matrix multiplications. And you typically have billions, you may have for the biggest model up to billions of weights and parameters to tune. So the dimension both of the data sets and of the network is really huge. And training and inference are becoming extremely demanding in terms of computing power. So this can be seen in particular, in this, which is that you can show that the compute needs for AI is actually doubling every 3.4 months as on the last, for instance, about 10 years. So this shows you the computing power in petaflop petaflop days along these years with different models from basically AlphaGo to a very simple one from a few years ago, and so on 7 years, if you take this 3.4 months doubling time, this corresponds to a need for computing of about 300,000 times. And in the same time, Moore's law has only been growing by a factor 7. So this is really a huge difference. So the need is growing much faster than the resources. And nowadays, if you want to train a single AI model on the biggest model, it can take thousands of petaflop days, and it can cost tens of millions of dollars just for the training. So for instance, this is GPT-3, is this most modern language model. And it took 3 million GPU hours to train. Okay, and meanwhile, so I was telling you about Moore's law, but Moore's law, as you may know, is slowing down. And nowadays, so this is the power, the some numbers to show the computing power. So you can show that frequency has been saturating in your computer to a few gigahertz for now more than 10 years. And power is saturating. So all this is basically limited by power dissipation. So there is some kind of physical limit of density and number of joules per operation that, that you can perform with a given electronics nowadays. And even if you keep diminishing the size of the transistor, the return is also diminishing. And the solution today has been to use multi-core processor and GPU. So this is nice. It solves. It does allow to scale the computation, but it poses other problem in terms of communication between cores. So the overall efficiency is still diminishing very much. Okay, and so this was this statement from basically big companies like the CEO of Microsoft, saying that the world is rapidly running out of capacity, and that AI could really consume a huge fraction of our power consumption by just in a few years, not 20 years, like 5 years. Okay, and the reason why it's also consuming so much and so inefficient is that because all current architecture is called a so-called von Neumann architecture, which was basically designed by von Neumann in the 40s, where computer architecture were kind of worked out. And generally, it works with some input that comes to some control unit where you have basically instruction. And it gives you an output, but most of the program and also the data is stored in a memory that is separate from the computing architecture. This is exactly what is done in your normal PC that has about 100 of gigaflops with a few hundred watts of communication. So this communication between the CPU and the memory is actually a huge bottleneck, because the communication, you need to exchange a lot of information. And there is this so-called von Neumann bottleneck, that is the problem of bringing the information from the memory to the CPU. And that's actually a huge limitation and a huge also power consumption. So it's extremely versatile. That's what it was adopted. You can do many things with it. It's actually not very well adapted for AI, because it's very, for this kind of computation of neural network, it's actually relatively slow and power inefficient. So things have been developing and GPU have been developed, which have, you know, about orders of magnitude more power than CPU. They are much more efficient to run many, many computations in parallel. And even really specialized chips like the TPU from Google, that is relatively efficient and also low power consumption. But they are all von Neumann architecture. So even though they alleviate and they try to limit this problem, they still suffer from the von Neumann bottleneck problem. And I really, if you're interested in this kind of topic, I really recommend this very nice paper called Hardware Lottery by Sarah Hooker, who's from basically Google Brain. And she was really advocating and discussing historically and also on modern architecture, how this hardware and software and algorithmic development really go hand in hand. And in a way, it's a symbiotic relation. And the you basically designed a specific algorithm for the hardware you have. And maybe there is many much better algorithm that you don't develop because you don't have the hardware. And vice versa, if you have new hardware, maybe it will trigger new algorithm to exploit them better. So it's a very nice perspective paper. And she really advocates for a better collaboration between hardware, software, and also the communities that develop them. Okay, so in order to address and try to circumvent the von Neumann bottleneck, some new architecture have been developed called neuromorphic that are trying to mimic the brain in a better way and mimic in order to be much more efficient for neural networks. And a good thing is machine learning, all this neural network architecture, you don't need such a high precision. You're actually happy with if you have a little bit of noise and error, it still works very much, very well. So analog computing is actually quite interesting and quite powerful for that. So can you do something like look a little bit more like a brain or like a physical neural network? And for instance, in electronics, you have this so-called memory sieve array or crossbar array that you can do in CMOS technology, where you have basically input wires and output wires like in orange and green. And at each connection, you can define with a potentiometer what is the weight of this coefficient. So it's exactly like a coefficient of a matrix, you can perform some really matrix multiplication, and then later on you can basically sum or apply some nonlinearity there. So it's a way to do electronically exactly this matrix multiplication. The good thing is there's no memory, so the memory is really, or the memory is really in the computer, in the computing unit itself. So you don't need to move the information from a memory and back. So it's extremely fast and energy efficient, and it can come in many flavors. So BEM restore, phase change material, spintronics, superconducting device, and so on and so forth. So there's a nice review that I can recommend on this, a very recent one. But these are all mostly solid state approaches. So in optics, we've been using optics for a long time to do some optical processing, and it started really from the 30s with just, you know, some masks trying to, you know, filter out light to do some kind of very simple computation. And in the 60s, we had the emergence of lasers and also of the emergence of modern optics. And you could show that just by propagating light through a lens, for instance, you can perform some complicated transformations, so convolution, Fourier transforms, and so on and so forth, in an analog way. And this was very much used in, for instance, radar image analysis. You could really directly form images from radar signal in an optical fashion. In the 80s and 90s, there was some really optical neural network that were developed. They were extremely complex and requiring a complicated optical device with, you know, crystals, nonlinear holograms, et cetera, et cetera. So it worked, and there was some really nice perceptron, for instance, implemented, but it was also extremely complex. So it was kind of slowly abandoned because Moore's law was growing very so fast. And in the 2000s, I think there was really a so-called winter for optical computing. So there was really very little done for about a decade, also because computers were growing so fast and the need for AI was not that big yet. So we didn't have this huge need for computing power. But I really want to point out that at the same time, there was a huge boom in optical communication. So the fact that optics is extremely good to transmit information with low power and huge bandwidth over very long distances, for instance, with fiber links. So this was really in the 2000s, but also in the last decade, the optical interconnect have been becoming more and more important in data centers. So basically, now everything that goes beyond a few meters for communication is done optically, almost. Nearly everything. Okay, so in the last decade or in the last 5 years, there was really a surge of interest in neuromorphic computing with light. Again, because optics has very distinct advantages that I was listing for optical communication. So there is very low energy consumption, easy interconnect. You can also multiplex, so use multiple wavelengths in parallel through the same circuit. And it's extremely fast and low latency. It has some disadvantage. It can be relatively bulky compared to electronics. And also it's extremely hard to get some storage or nonlinearity of light. This is a big issue. And there are two, let's say, competing approaches that have been adopted. One is more free space, like think of, you know, lenses, telescopes, large detectors, and so on. And one is really integrated optics, which is basically making extremely small waveguides on chip. It's very much similar to basically electronic chips, except that you guide light on small waveguide and you have a lot of devices on chip that you can use. So if you're interested, there is this, for instance, two recent reviews from last year or the beginning of the year on all these optical approaches for AI and optics. So I want to review some of these approaches, but really the take-home message up to this point is you have to think that even though you're using neural network without maybe realizing, it's just matrix multiplication. And this matrix multiplication are hugely inefficient at large scale on a normal PC or GPU. So I want to illustrate a few of the way we can do this operation in optics in a good way. So the first one is this crossbar array. So that I was showing you before. You can actually do it in optics, and this was shown last year. Actually, it was this was a European group, but there was a very similar work from an Australian group recently. Sorry. And you can really do this in optics. So you have really waveguide for light here, and at each crossing, you can basically have a small device that basically allows you to reroute light with a certain a certain fraction of the light into the perpendicular waveguide. And in this way, you can have basically optically or electronically addressable levels, coefficient of the matrix. And this is a fully passive system. So once this system has been set, you can basically perform the matrix multiplication at no computing cost almost. And it's really based on this material that can, it's called phase change material, that you can basically change the index of refraction in a static way. So this is of course a nice realization, and this is the paper from Australia that you may have heard of, where people have been doing this, using this kind of device, and they've been demonstrating the so-called frequency multiplexing advantage. So once you have a device like that, the good thing is if you send one wavelength, you can actually send multiple wavelengths in parallel through the same circuit, and you can basically separate them again after the circuit in order to, with the same chip, perform the operation in. It's like a multi-core. You can perform in parallel this operation at the same speed and energy consumption. So it's based on this so-called frequency comb lasers, which carry many, many frequencies simultaneously. So this is one advantage of this platform. So another approach is a bit different is the so-called integrated Mach-Zehnder interferometer. So what you want to use is you want to use the ability of small circuits to basically, when you combine them, you can basically tune with some small phase shift on the light on these waveguides. You can check how they combine. You can make some kind of 2x2 operation, so 2x2 mixers, and if you then combine these units in different ways, you can build some unitary circuits, so some small matrix transformation that may look like that. So this is a relatively small, like millimeters, and the good thing is you can perform this operation. Then you can perform gigahertz operation modulation through these circuits. The problem maybe is that of course there is a huge overhead in terms of wiring, because you need to tune all these individual circuits in a very complex way, and it can be extremely bulky. But still, when you do that, you can basically get on this integrated circuit small size circuit, like few tens times 10 unitary circuits, but you can go at gigahertz speed. So in terms of number of operation, it's actually good. And it's also fab compatible. So you can really fabricate it in a normal electronic facility, which is of course very good for costs. Okay, so if you go to free space optics, then you, as I was saying, telling you, you can just use the fact that just propagation is an operation on the field, so is a matrix multiplication. So if you propagate a field from one plane to the next, you basically perform some kind of kernel operation on this space, and you can show that it's equivalent to some kind of simple matrix. And of course, if you take a mask, like a grating or a lens or anything, you can see that as a multiplication by some kind of diagonal matrix, like a local operation on the fields. So if you now combine in a complex way propagation, masks, and different circuits, it's equivalent to performing some kind of multiplication between all these individual or block matrices, and with that you can get some more complex transformation or that you implement optically. You can even use a volumetric object, and then it will also perform a very complex operation. So from these individual building blocks, you can build some interesting things. So for instance, you can build a convolution operator. So if you convolve, for instance, propagation, lens propagation, it's like a Fourier transform. Then you have a mask and then another Fourier transform. So Fourier transform multiplication, Fourier transform is a convolution. You can also do some kind of 1D matrix, vector matrix multiplier. So you can have a series of inputs, some lenses, mask, and combining to multiple detectors. And you can make arbitrary and programmable matrix vector multiplication optically. So just to show you one example, this is a paper from a group from Stanford, where they have some kind of input plane that they use a DMD, which are this modulator that you have in this display like beamers. And then you have this Fourier transform with propagation, lens propagation. And then you have a mask that has been fabricated to implement a specific operation. So this is a small mask that you put in the Fourier plane. And then you perform the Fourier transform again, and you can just directly on the camera measure this. So this is a way to perform this operation, this convolution optically. And then you need, this, there is a wire coming out of your camera, and then you can have an additional small, electronic circuit, like a small classifier or, small layer to do some classification later on. So you kind of have an hybrid approach where part of the things are done optically and part of the things are done electronically. Okay, so you can also do even reconfigurable convolution. So for instance, if you, instead of putting a fixed mask in the middle, you put one of these DMD modulators, you can actually change the convolution in real time and or even, multiplex convolution in one plane in order to perform this operation at relatively fast speed. So this was what was shown in this paper. And you can really do this massively parallel Fourier convolution. So beyond that, beyond just this convolution, people have been proposing. So this is a very popular paper from just a few years ago in Science, where they were basically using multiple masks, one after the other. And in this way, they were calling it this deep diffractive network, because you have multiple layers and masks. It was done in a terahertz because it was really fabricated. So you have to do that much bigger scale. So this is really a centimeter scale, but it was performing these multiple layers optically. So maybe I just want to point out that this was called a deep diffractive network, but it's just propagation and masks. So there's no nonlinearity in the whole network, except at the end on the detector side. So it's just, in a way, you can think of it as just one dense single layer neural network from a fundamental perspective. There's no deep in there in the sense of deep neural network with multiple hidden layers with nonlinearity. So it just behaves as a single layer, but you can really configure at will the weights. So this is all these free space optics. They are very nice because they are extremely large size. Typically, you can have millions of pixels in and out. So your cameras and modulators and detectors, they have really tens of millions of detectors. So you can really go to large size. They tend to be a bit slow. So instead of being gigahertz, they're more like kilohertz at best. But if you take the large size, it's actually a lot of operation. And they're actually quite big. So that's also a problem. And again, there's no nonlinearity that you can have during the propagation. So the nonlinearity has to be at the end, at the detection. You detect the field, so you have a modulus square when you measure the intensity, and that's a nonlinearity you have. Getting nonlinearity inside is extremely complicated. Maybe one point, so I was telling you that this is very low power consumption, and this was actually shown in this paper that is just on archive, so it's just a preprint, but it showed very convincingly that you can do this matrix multiplication. So I won't go into the details of the setup here, but the good thing is they could show that they could do some classification. So it's a one layer neural network, and they could get a very good decent accuracy on NIST, about 90%. But there was the interesting point is the whole operation was taking much less than one photon pair operation, which is extremely low in terms of energy. So this is really a good example of how low consumption an optical neural network can be. Okay, so let me, I have just have a few 10 more minutes that I want to use to show you a little bit what we've been doing in my group. And we've been trying to do some optical computing with a complex medium. And I will define a little bit what we mean, but in a way, I try to convince you that we have basically modulators and detectors. So we have basically special light modulator that we can use to encode some information. And the light that has been encoded on this modulator can go through a complex medium. I will define in a moment what it is. And then it can go to a camera. So the question is, okay, can we use these things to do some machine learning? So it sounds very counterintuitive, but I will show you that it is the case. So the physics of what we are doing is basically sending light, or think of just a wave, and the light will come into a disordered material. And this can be just, you know, white paint, for instance. White paint or paper is a diffusive material because it's like a disordered material where light will be perturbated in a very complex way. So if you send a pulse of light into such a disordered material, the pulse will enter and will be scattered in a very, very complex way. So you really have this bouncing back and forth inside this medium until some light is transmitted, most of the light is reflected, and you see this extremely complex pattern. So this is what we call multiple scattering. So you can think of also of, you know, clouds or fog as you know, a good example of such diffusive or mixing material. But of course, we do it on a much smaller scale, for instance, in white paint or paper. So when you do this, you have no more ballistic light. It's just really light. Every light that has gone through has been extremely strongly perturbated. And there is a very big temporal mixing and spatial mixing. But still, you have to think a laser is a very coherent wave. So it has the ability to interfere, to produce interferences, just like interference fringes that you've learned at school, but much more complex. And which is what you see here, it's interferences. So what we've shown in my group, which was really the start of my research group about 10 years ago, we've shown that if what you can do is measure this input, the input-output relation of a complex medium. So you take a complex medium, you have pixel at the input that you can control, pixel that you can detect, and you can measure the linear relation, which is extremely complex, between this input and output modes for a complex medium. And you can show that it looks like that. So it's a so-called transmission matrix of the medium, and it looks like noise. And it looks like completely random. And we could show that it was really this matrix that we could measure was very close to a random matrix. So we could follow some good prediction from the so-called quarter circle, random matrix theory, that you can show that if you take MATLAB, you throw away a bunch of numbers in a matrix form, and you look at the singular value distribution or distribution of eigenvalues of your matrix, you will find something similar. So in a way, we can retrieve the properties of a very complex, of a random matrix. And this matrix, if you take a layer of paint, it will be extremely stable. So the same medium will have the same matrix for days or weeks. The other advantage is optics, the diffractions, the size of diffraction of optics, so the individual mode that we can control, they are of the order of a micron. So if you have a medium that is just 1 millimeter thick and wide, it has basically millions of modes already, input and output modes. So the take-home message was that we realized at the time that propagation of light for disordered medium can be shown to be a multiplication by a random matrix, okay? And this was something we used for a very long time for imaging purposes. But we just realized a few years ago with collaborators in signal processing that this is actually an operation, this multiplication by a random matrix, that is very much used in signal processing. It's called random projection. And it's actually a very broadly used operation for signal processing and machine learning. So I want to show two examples of what random projections are good for. The first one is so-called dimensional reduction. So if you take a data set, so input point in high dimension, input vectors in high dimension, what you can do is you can reduce the dimensionality tremendously by multiplying by a random matrix that would reduce this input data set to an output data set at a different dimension m that can be much lower than m. So there is some very strong mathematical proof that say that even if M is much lower than N, the random matrix will basically conserve distances, scalar products, and angles with a very high accuracy. So the data set here and the data set here, they have almost the same structure. So whatever you can do on this initial data set that may be huge, you can also do in terms of classification on this lower lower dimensional data set. But it would be much easier because the data set is much smaller. Another example of random projection is actually the opposite operation. So instead of going from a large dimensional space to a small dimensional space, so dimensional reduction, you can do the opposite. You can start from a given data set and explode it with a random matrix to much larger dimension. And when you do this, there is another advantage that you can start from a problem that is extremely complicated with a very complicated nonlinear boundary between classes, for instance. And by going to larger dimension, you can make the problem separable, linearly separable. So you make the problem much more easy computationally, even though it's in higher dimension. So this is the so-called kernel trick, and this has been also used, these two papers are either mathematical or really signal processing, but of course not optical. So they've been used mathematically. The problem is that these matrices can be very big, and if they are very big, they are very costly to perform. Okay, and for all these operations, I think that's an important point. You don't need to know the matrix, you just need to know that it's random. So if you perform this operation optically, you don't need to know, you don't need to have characterized this transmission matrix. That would be very long. You can just use the fact that you have a disordered medium to perform this operation. So why is it interesting? And I just want to give you the flavor of why it's interesting to do it in optics. It's because these matrices are very large. So I was telling you millions of input and output modes. So the numbers of coefficients of the operation you're performing when is about 10 to the 12. So if you would have to do this operation in a computer, you would need terabytes of memory. So if you want to do this operation at scale 1 million, you actually can't do it, because not just because it's a lot of operation, it's because you don't have the memory to do it. So there will be a huge bottleneck if you have to bring all this information from the memory to the CPU or to the GPU to perform it. So it's also very fast. So again, you can do this multiplication at about kilohertz rate in optics. So it's not super fast per se, but it's super fast when you multiply this number. So if you put 6, 6, and 3, this is like 15. So you are performing 10 to the 15 operation per second, which is basically a supercomputer. So to perform this particular operation, the optics would be extremely interesting, because you can do this at very low consumption. So this was actually what triggered us to create this spin-off that Kostas was mentioning at the beginning, called Lighton. We really use this kind of device. We actually perform exactly this operation of using a modulator and a detector to perform this operation optically. And we have quite a few use cases, for instance, in inference, training, high dimensional linear algebra. So there's many things you can do with this. And it's already at scale for modern machine learning. So it's not an advertisement, but it's also, I think, the first optical processor that you can actually buy. So it's commercial already. So this was just to give you a flavor. And I come now to my conclusion. I try to convince you that optics and photonics have unique advantage for current and future artificial neural networks. Optics is very fast and large dimensional and very low power consumption. What's still very much of an issue is how to tune the weights and train the weights, and how to have non-linearities optically. That's very hard. And also it's quite bulky. So these are things we worked on, and at least for the solution we developed, we don't have this problem because of this random but fixed neural networks. So there's no fully optical deep neural network yet. It's just single layers. Most of the implementation are hybrid. So in a way, you have one optical layer and an other electronic processing later on. And we're still doing in optics relatively simple proof of principle and proof of concept experiments. So most people use relatively small data sets. So some specialized architecture are successful. So I couldn't mention them all, but there is something called reservoir computing that is very popular in optics. I know it's used in some context in robotics, but not with optical implementation. And of course, this was not a comprehensive review. I couldn't present everything. There is many, many things that are going on in optics that I couldn't really cover here today. So in terms of perspective, I think there is at the moment an effort into trying to make a convergence between this free space implementation and this integrated optics implementation that are really two different worlds. And maybe there's a possibility to get the best of both worlds. I think this concept of hardware lottery and the convergence between the hardware and the software is really important. And again, I really point out this nice paper of Sarah Hooker. And I didn't mention it today, so I was speaking only about classical computing, but there is a strong effort in optics to do also some quantum computing. And I believe many of the tools are actually similar. These networks are actually also used in quantum optics and quantum computing. So there's probably a nice convergence to reach between classical and quantum machine learning. Okay, with that, I'm at the end of my talk. I just want to present the team that's a photo from pre-pandemic, but these are the people, and we have also a lot of collaboration, none in Austria at the moment, but we have a large network of collaborators, both in the computing part, imaging part, and so on. So with that, I stopped, and I'm at the end of my talk, and I really thank you for your attention. I hope you enjoyed the talks, and I'm happy to have any questions.
Thank you very much for this excellent talk, and we've got some time for questions. And I see Don already is raising his hand.
Merci, Sylvain, for that fantastic talk. Excuse me, I was at the edge of my seat the whole way. It's totally fascinating and very exciting. I have so many questions, but I think maybe it's mostly around those areas you identified as the sore points right now. So maybe I can just pick on one. What is the hope for an optical nonlinearity moving forward? So is it possible that we'll find a way to do that?
Yes. So I think what's difficult is really to have a fully map a deep neural network with nonlinearities in the middle that you can predefine. That's actually hard. I can maybe, let me check. Yeah, so there was some interesting recent work, for instance, of trying to put some nonlinearities inside a network. And I can point, this is a recent archive, where what they do is they use a multimode fiber for propagation. So the multimode fiber is like a propagation with some kind of linear transformation. And they had some nonlinearities in the fiber. So it's a fiber with some, I think, Brillouin nonlinearity. And in this way, it's not really a nonlinear network with multiple layers with matrix multiplication nonlinearity, matrix multiplication nonlinearity. It's kind of all together. And you have a system that is basically a system that is both propagation and nonlinearity. So you cannot directly map it to the properties of a deep neural network, but what you can show is that this kind of system behaves better than just a linear system. So it's more, the performances are better than a linear neural network, a one-layer neural network. So this is maybe one way to introduce some nonlinearity inside an optical system. It's extremely hard to have a system. I mean, these nonlinearities are very tough because if you want to do optical nonlinearity along the way, you need either a gain medium like a laser gain medium, or you need really some nonlinear crystal or some photorefractive material. And they are all extremely complicated to build. They are all extremely complicated to manage. You need high power and so on. So it's actually, this is why it's super complicated. So this is an elegant solution to this problem. That is probably something to follow, for instance.
Yeah, that's great. That you've also answered my second question was going to be, instead of starting with something we know we're pretty good at digitally, like multiply accumulate or convolution, and then trying to emulate it optically, does it make more sense to start with things we know we're good at optically and then train that optics to do things in a different but learnable way?
Yeah, exactly. So this is I think exactly the point of this paper, that we need a better convergence, and we need to maybe see what we can do in optics and maybe really find a good use case that may not be just mapping it to a deep learning network, because that's just too hard.
Yeah.
So I think it's really about finding a good use for whatever we can do in optics.
Fantastic. Thank you. I'll let someone else take up your time. Thanks.
I think Steph was next with his hand.
Merci, Sylvain. That was great. I had a question about you mentioned the random matrix multiplications that we were doing, you know, the projections and compression. In a lot of the sort of early classification work, there was a, you know, projecting to get linearly separable classes. But presumably there's some structure in that kernel matrix that must be found to ensure that the classes become separable in an efficient way. So how programmable are those sorts of optical elements so that you can search for a space where things, you know, become easier to either separate classes or get a compression that really accentuates the features of interest if you were doing some classification tests?
Yes. Okay, that's an excellent question. Thank you. So I think there is two parts to your question. So one thing is indeed, if you want to do dimensional reduction or kernel expansion to classify, normally you need to kind of know what is the structure of your data in order to fine tune this transformation to maximize the efficiency. So, and indeed in optics, you could think of, you know, programming that into a device. I think the advantage of this random matrix multiplication and random projection is they are basically structure independent. So you don't need to know what is the structure that you have, and you still have some bounds in what kind of, final separation, separability or linear ability to have a linear classifier that you will have. These performances bounds are valid in infinite dimension in principle. So mathematically speaking, I think they have been proven in extremely large dimension, but at least for relatively large dimension, they are still relatively valid. So that's an important point of this random projection, that you don't need to know the structure of the data. They are data independent. So I'm not sure if this answers your question.
Yeah, but presumably there are some structures of those matrices that will give you better properties. And I guess I'm imagining these things as sort of a bit of glass with some kind of, you know, thing that change, you know, that seems like it would be fairly fixed once you made it. So is it something that you can kind of adjust and permute to look for projections that are effective to solve the particular problem that you're trying to solve?
Yes. Absolutely, yes. So if you have a problem where you know the data set, that's probably better than a random projection to do. And maybe you can do it in a way that you have a structure transformation that will give you a good separability, not going to too high dimension. So there's probably a better solution than random. Random is a good solution when you don't know anything. And the good thing is random is easy for us to do. So, you know, you spray white paint on a glass slide and voila, you have a random medium. And you know that it will be random with a very good accuracy, and you know you can use it. Fabricating a well-defined transform optically is extremely complicated. You can do it. You have methods to actually design some 3D structure, but they are extremely costly and long and prone to error when you scale them up. So that's why I think the random approach has its advantages.
Yeah, that's great. I think that answers my question.
But you can do what you say. Very nice talk. You can do what you say.
Yeah. Yep. Excellent. Thanks.
Thank you.
We're coming up to the hour now, but I think we still got time for another question. Mikael has raised his hand.
Hi, Sylvain. I was just had quick questions. Do you still want to use this in your algorithms to try to multiplex, because the light has the advantage of multiplexing at least with polarization and wavelengths, which is not too hard. So are you thinking of actually trying to scale up the number of operations by multiplexing with wavelengths? And second question related to this is, how would you detect if you multiplex as well? Because it doesn't scale well with the number of different channels you want to measure.
Yeah. Thank you, Mikael. So Mikael is a former group member, so I still have a connection in Australia now. And that's indeed a very good question. So in free space, it's actually difficult to multiplex because you need to send multiple wavelengths. So that's easy to send multiple wavelengths, but then you would need to basically code the different information on each wavelength. So you still need to separate them, use different modulators or different place on the same modulator for different wavelengths. And after propagation through the medium, you will need to split again. So the multiplexing advantage in free space is actually hard to exploit. It's much easier to exploit in fibers or in integrated circuit where you have some, let's say, well-designed multiplexer that you can buy off the shelf for communication, for instance. So the multiplexing advantage is hard to exploit. On the other hand, the polarization multiplexing is easy to exploit. And in a way, I think what we've been doing so far is just, you know, we don't need to multiplex because we have so many spatial modes that we didn't use yet. So I think we still have the nice point of free space is the dimension is so huge already that the multiplexing is not really something you need to use. If you go to an integrated chip where you have maybe 10 or 20 or 100 modes, then multiplexing becomes extremely important if you want to, and speed is extremely important if you want to have a high data rate.
Yeah, okay. And then have someone been like looking at what you were saying before in trying to exploit optical nonlinearities for this neural network by having like these white paints, because you have some nonlinear effects in white paint as well if you send a high power pulse. So could this be used as well?
So it could be, it could be, it has not been done, but it could be in principle. I think the beauty of the approach I was mentioning to answer Don's question about this multimode fiber with some gain is that if you do, if you use a nonlinearity in a multimode fiber, you can do it at relatively low power. So it's not, it really avoid this problem of using extremely powerful laser or, you know, also power consumption because you have the confinement. So you could in principle do it in a disordered medium with some gain or nonlinearity. But you would need to probably fry your system in order to get something useful. So it probably, I think the fiber is a good way to solve this problem.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we're past the hour now, so let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you all.
Thank you for coming and presenting, or well, not coming but presenting.